I'd like to start with an apology, but my lecture's in English. Like many Englishmen, I speak only one language well. But the other reason is, people say to me, why don't you learn our language? Well, I'd love to, but I have lectured in just over 50 countries. It would be a bit difficult. So, today, I want to talk about learning and the abstract that I gave is an abstract that I actually wrote for a theoretical paper which is submitted for publication. But basically the idea is that we know more than we can tell. But once we take this idea seriously, we have to take our understanding of learning more seriously than we have done. And so, in this morning's presentation, I want to talk about becoming an expert and show how it impinges upon different ways of learning. And in a real sense, my paper could be said to revolve around Husserl's quote, that I live in my acts, that I am what I do. And so here is my starting point. But during the presentation, I want to rehearse some learning experiences from my own career. I've got three down there, but the other day I changed it and put a fourth in. But I want to show something different about learning. And I also want to show the relationship between learning and conscious awareness. And so I have broken my presentation up in the following way. And let me start with the idea of conscious learning from experience. For this is where I actually began my own work on learning many years ago. When I trained as a sociologist, the work of Schutz and Luckman were very well known. It was the idea of how do we structure our own reality. And in a book they wrote in 1974, they wrote, I trust that the world as it has been known by me up to now will continue further, and that consequently the stock of knowledge obtained from my fellow men and formed from my own experiences will continue to preserve its fundamental validity. From this assumption follows a further one, that I can repeat my past successful acts. So long as the structure of the world can be taken as constant, as long as my previous experience is valid, my ability to act upon the world in this or that manner remains in principle preserved. Well, in the 70s, you could probably just about get away with that. Because since then, the world has changed a lot more rapidly. And to say I can assume that the world hasn't changed very much has a number of problems. And very frequently, I am confronted with questions. How do I do it? Why do I do it? What's it for? And it was at this point I called disjuncture. I can't presume upon the world, or not as often as I would like to. I live in a world which is questioning. And so disjuncture can cause dissonance. It can cause dissonance in knowledge, in skills, in senses, in emotions and beliefs. You see, it's not just a knowledge thing. It could be a smell thing. Or it could be an attitude thing. It can be a slight gap between what we expect to find and what we do find. And then, to some extent, we can still do what Schultz and Luckman said. We can presume upon the world because it's not changed that much. But there's a lot of larger gaps occurring now. And these demand considerable learning. For instance, when I meet a stranger, disjuncture can occur because we don't speak the same language, we don't have the same expectations, we have different cultures, and it takes time for us to establish a relationship. We're learning all the time. But just think of the disjuncture that we can have in our emotion. When we go to see an absolutely wonderful, beautiful scenery, it causes awe. And awe is an experience, it's an emotional experience of disjuncture. I don't and can't take this beautiful world for granted. So I have a disjunctural experience about it. And so we learn from our disjunctural experiences. We incorporate the outcomes of our learning in our thoughts and our actions and emotions into ourselves, into our bodies, into our minds. And we change as a result of our learning. And so, cognitive learning begins with the conscious experience of not knowing. And when I don't know, I have to try and close that gap between my experience and my memory, as it were. And that's where learning begins. And so I actually defined learning as a combination of processes throughout a lifetime whereby the whole person, body, genetic, physical, and biological, and mind, knowledge, skills, attitudes, values, emotions, meanings, beliefs, and senses, experience natural and social situations, the content of which is then transformed cognitively, emotively, or practically, or through any combination, and integrated into the individual person's biography, resulting in a continually changing or more experienced person. That's a little bit more of a complicated definition than I found in the textbooks when I started reading about learning many years ago. And yet, whilst I've lived with this definition and the diagram that follows for quite a long time now in my life, I've always, at the end of all my books, been very dissatisfied because I know that I hadn't mastered the problem. Even though, if you look at that diagram, if I start in the top corner and I look at the idea of disjuncture, which is box 2, and then I can think about it, can have emotions about it, and I can act about it, and the outcomes of those, my learning is box 6, and then box 7 is me starting all over again. But I have to confess that one of the problems with what has been the basis of so much of my writing and the dissatisfaction I've had because I've not solved it lies in two issues that come in that diagram and in that definition. The first is disjuncture itself. And the second is consciousness. You see, I'm always conscious of disjuncture. Disjuncture is an experience of my consciousness. But this is not what happens in many of our professional experiences. Many years ago, Algiris and Sean began to get a hold of this when they said professionals and professional educators, practitioners of all sorts, often speak of practicing and learning skills as though those activities were an entirely different sort than learning a theory. They got to the idea that there was more than one type of learning. And they typified it by talking about espoused theory and theory in use. And significantly, they suggested that learning tacit knowledge may be a different process from learning espoused or explicit knowledge. And that this form of learning may be learned anywhere. And so, in the next five brief sections of this paper, I want to take that conclusion, this form of learning might be learned anywhere, and build on it. And one of the first scholars who began to raise questions about this was Polanyi. He wrote before Algiris and Sean, but he wrote in a very difficult English language that American scholars wouldn't understand. Sorry, that's very racist. They wouldn't get the books wouldn't have got there. They started from a Gestalt problem. But significantly, you've only got to go back to Plato and to the Meno, and you find that Plato was dealing with just the same problem. How did the Meno know these things? He had to postulate that there was knowledge before birth, but perhaps we've moved on a bit. And Polanyi focused upon two types of awareness. And this, I think, was a very interesting insight. Just imagine that I'm a practical person and I've got a nail and a hammer and I'm knocking nails in, right? So I'm there knocking away and I'm aware of what I'm doing, but there's something else. I'm holding a hammer and at first I'm aware of the feeling of the hammer. But as the action goes on, the feeling about the hammer disappears. It gets subsumed into the one feeling about the action. And so there's a second experience which we are no longer really conscious of, because the first one, the watching the hammer and knocking the nail in, is preoccupying. And yet the second one is actually quite important. Because you see, if something happened and you suddenly felt the hammer differently, you'd have that an experience of knowing. Because you don't have an experience of knowing, you're having an experience without knowing it. Which itself is a very interesting philosophical problem. How can I have an experience without knowing it? But I do, all the time. And herein lies the other bit of the mystery of learning. So, let me move on a little bit. Because, this, strangely enough, is not the overhead that I thought I'd sent. So I'm going to have to talk to you without the overhead and give you the overhead afterwards. Sorry, this is, you could say this is a senior problem, but it's a little bit more than a senior problem because I've been very ill and I've only just, this is my first lecture since I came out of hospital, really. But I'll go back if I can. Can you come and find me the beginning again? Because I will talk to those overheads and put in the bits I want to put in. Because there's another overhead, and I'll give it to you afterwards. Go right back to the beginning. Let me start again. Go on to where I was talking before about Metis. Yeah. Okay, fine. Go back to the little bit there. Right. Now, in the overhead I actually sent you, I divided this these experiences differently. But let me talk here about that one I just said about the hammer and the knowing, because I had many years ago I had an experience of learning. Just what I've been talking about today, in Fukuoka in Japan. I was very privileged to go to Japan as a JSPS scholar and spend a month there. And during that time, I was traveling around Japan, meeting lots of scholars and talking about lifelong learning. And with a Canadian scholar, I traveled down to a place called Fukuoka in the south of Japan. And my Japanese host in Fukuoka met us on the bullet train, put us in his car, and took us to the hotel. At the hotel, we left our bags in our rooms, got our keys, left them at the reception, got in his car, and we went into Fukuoka. No problems. He showed us around this beautiful city for an hour or so. And then he said to us, gentlemen, he said, I'm very sorry, I have to leave you now. I have a very important meeting to go to. But there's no problem getting back to the hotel. Here's the train station. You just get a ticket for four stops. And when you get there, he said, just come out and get to the hotel. So, no problems, you know. We went and got a meal in a Japanese restaurant. This is very easy in Japan because all the menus got pictures on. And then we got our tickets and got on the train. We drove and we went to four stations and we got up off the train. And then the problems emerged. You see, we got off the train. Neither of us read Japanese. There was no exit signs in English. So we had to go out. So we followed the crowd. No problems, we got out onto the main road. But the hotel wasn't there. Now, that's when the problem really began. You see, we didn't have a key because we'd left them at the reception. So we didn't know the name of the hotel. We didn't know the road it was in and we didn't know its telephone number. Now, can you imagine a Canadian and a British person going up to a Japanese and saying, can you show us where our hotel is? What's its name? We walked up and down the roads looking for this blinking hotel. And I've got to a point of depression when I thought, well, this is the first night in my life I'm going to be homeless. And then an interesting experience occurred. I was standing in the middle of the road, and I said to my colleague, Alan, the hotel's just down that road, on a dog leg, round the corner, it's on the right-hand side. So we would have tried anything at that time. So we walked up the road, found the dog leg, and lo and behold, the hotel was there. How did you know? I have no idea how I knew. But we went to bed because relieved. But like good researchers, the following morning we were back up that road looking. And then it dawned on me. You see, as I stood there in the middle of the road the night before, I was standing in exactly the same place I'd gone over when I was sitting in the car being taken to the hotel. And the picture of that which I got from sitting in the car suddenly flashed up in my mind. Yeah? Now, how many times do we have that experience, but because we don't consciously conjure it up afterwards, we don't know we've had it? And if I hadn't consciously conjured that up in a few minutes, the problem would have been, it would have gone. Because these fleeting memories are short term and don't last very long necessarily. Or perhaps they do and we don't know it. But the interesting thing is I had learned where that hotel was without being conscious of my learning, without even knowing that I knew where it was. Now that's very important, because I was having a secondary experience which I didn't get into my conscious mind, but it was affecting my behavior. Now, how often, genuinely speaking, does that occur? I don't know. Because I don't know when I have those experiences, and I don't know when I've remembered them. But I'm learning. I'm learning without knowing that I'm learning. Now, that's important, because if you go back to my initial thing, say, my learning began with a disjuncture. When I have these experiences, there is no disjuncture. There's just a matter that I'm taking into my mind an experience that I don't know about. Now, the important part of this, you see, is not just that I'm learning this thing without knowing it. So let me tell you another story. It's about nurses and nurse education. For much of my career, I've been very privileged to train nurse educators. Surrey was the biggest training school for nurse education for a number of years. And I devised a little experiment. I used to say to the nurses in my class, now, what I want you to do is to write down a definition of learning. Right? They all wrote their definitions there. They're all different. It didn't matter. I didn't ask to see them. I said, now, let's put the definitions aside. Because now what I want you to do is I want you to say, to take me. Say, I'm not a nurse, I'm not medical, I don't know anything about illness, apart from all the illnesses I haven't got. But I said, you walk me down a ward, and I say to you, can you recognize the illness by the odors coming from the bed? Yeah? And they will say, yes, we can recognize the odors. So how did you acquire the knowledge of the smell And they said, well, we learned it. So I said, well, let's go back to your definition of learning. How many of you have got some Eldel now? Nobody. Nobody ever had smell. But how do you learn smells? How do you learn tastes? I didn't know that I knew. And those nurses probably didn't know that they knew until they were at the bed and smelt the odour and said, ah, yes, that's. So, what we're doing is that we are learning without being aware that we are learning. Asked somebody to describe it and they couldn't. And yet we know. We know, as Polanyi said, more than we know. But we know it about every smell. And so think of your practice. How many other things do you know without knowing you know? Yeah? So, let me tell you another story. The last one there. Because this it is the heart of what we're talking about. 3 years ago, I was working for a while in Kyoto University. And the students there, three of them, took me for big department store. And they took me to the top floor where they had weavers weaving Japanese silk. Now, you know how beautiful Japanese silk is. This was a piece of weaving that was beyond one's understanding. They'd been working at it for 4 years. One piece of silk and two weavers for 4 years. It was massive and it was beautiful. It was going to cost a fortune. And I said to my students as we watched these two elderly gentlemen, they had 300 strands of silk that they were weaving together. So I said to them, my students, ask them how long it's taken them to learn to be weavers of this experience. The answer came back, at least 10 years. Well, funnily enough, that afternoon they also took me to one of these fabulous old Japanese tea making places. And I watched the chef dishing out his dough for his tea. He never weighed anything. And as he put it down, everyone looked exactly the same. So I said to the students, ask him how long he's been doing this. And they said, oh, 10 years. Now, read Pamela Benner, Patricia Benner, novice to expert. She says it takes a long time to be an expert. The general assumption in the literature now is you can't become an expert under 10,000 hours. 10,000 hours of doing the same thing. But you see, there's a problem with that. We say, when we watch these Chinese people, it's just rote learning. But the interesting thing is that when you ask them, as some researchers have done, it isn't rote learning. Because every time they do it, their meaning changes a little. Or their practice changes a little, almost minutely. But it's changing all the time. In Osaka, the International Hotel there had a fantastic reputation a few years ago for making the most wonderful bread. And a company making bread making machines wanted to capture the brilliance of the chef. But they went and asked him, and he couldn't tell them. He couldn't tell them what made his bread making different. And they watched and they watched. And in the end, that bread making company had to employ a researcher to work as the bread maker's apprentice for 6 months to write down everything, literally everything, the cook did, until they found it was just one little twirl at some stage in the process which was different. Now, I think that trying to capture somebody's professional expertise like that has a number of ethical problems, because in a sense it was that man's expertise, and why should it get into a machine? But the point is, we have so much de-skilled many occupations that you don't need this type of expertise, because the machine does it. It doesn't do it with crafts, and it doesn't do it with people-based professions. So while we talk about competences, it's wrong. As Benner says, competence is only halfway. To be an expert is to go the rest of the way. And to learn that expertise means just what I say. Doing it, and doing it. Not being aware that we are learning, just doing it. And letting that little bit of learning, that little slight change, be built into our system. So over the years, we take it for granted. Now the point is, we learn to forget. And the longer you've been in practice, when a student comes up to you to say, how do I do this? Sometimes it's difficult for us to say, because, you know, we've learned to forget that explicit knowledge. Because what we've taken in is the whole. And what we've taken in, therefore, are all the little bits, as well as the big bits. And we see the thing holistically. So we know when somebody's got it wrong. But to be able to say, this is what you do, is sometimes difficult. And so we're learning to do without knowing that we're learning to do, because we don't have any disjuncture. We're doing it all the time. It's just affecting us slightly all the time. And by just affecting us slightly, our expertise is growing. But ask, for somebody to ask us how to do it, we could well be like that baker, not being able to say precisely what we do. So that really has its own problems for the theory of learning that I have produced. Because I have internalized my practice without being aware that I'm doing it. It's just happening. And in that sense, I have learned to forget all the things that when I began, all the little skills I had to learn, the procedures I had to learn, because as it becomes holistic, we forget the individual things. So we learn to forget all the individual things, and our knowledge of doing becomes tacit. Now, at this point, it's very interesting when you watch the expert who just seems to know and the manager, who just seems to know. Now, there's been some recent work in management theory by a man called Sadler Smith. And he says many of the great managers make their decisions within 30 seconds. The whole of the future of the company may depend upon a 30-second intuitive response. Now, is it really something that's just intuitive like that? Or is it the years of internalizing things, learning to forget, and then in the situation, I can bring forward and I can step beyond the procedure because I have this intuitive knowledge. Sadler Smith says we have two minds. We have an analytical mind and we have an intuitive mind. Now the interesting thing is the intuitive mind is faster than the analytical mind. And we all have this experience. You think sometimes you have a very difficult experience and suddenly something flashes to your mind, I should do that. And then a half a second later, say, I'm not sure. Yeah? Now that's the two minds. That's the intuitive mind saying, do this. And the analytical mind saying, just a minute. You know, just a minute. But you see, interestingly, the analytical mind is the mind, but you might tell me the intuitive mind is the body, and that the bodily learning is faster than the analytical learning. And the more that we have internalized, the more the body responds, as it were. And for those of you who know about the brain, bodily learning doesn't go through the amygdala, it goes directly to the neocortex. So the time lapse is the lapse in the two roots. You see? And so we are always exposed to two roots and two minds. Now, this is very interesting. You say, well, haven't people known about this for years? And the answer is yes. Because a French scholar a few years ago discovered the Greek concept metis knowledge. M-E-T-I-S, metis knowledge. Metis knowledge is conjectural knowledge. The Greeks knew about conjectural knowledge 500 years before Christ. And the philosophers killed it. So in the ancient Greek literature, there's ideas floating around of conjectural knowledge, metis. And we all have conjectural knowledge. And the more we spend our time in practice, the more that conjectural knowledge operates within us. And sometimes when we're doing things, and you know this as well as I do, better than me, you think, oh damn it, those rules are really rubbish. I think I can work it out better. Yeah? That's my conjectural knowledge, saying, I know. I can see the end product. I don't need to go through the rules, because I'm an expert. I've internalized it. I've made it me. I've not had to go through the disjunctural experience of learning cognitive knowledge. I just know what to do. Now the fascinating thing in learning theory, you will know this better than me, is when we teach our students to do, we don't teach them to do, we teach them skills. And that's a travesty of doing. You see, for me to decide to do is I have to make a decision. I have to make a decision of which way I am going to do it. Yes? Learning to do is not like learning to know. It's a very, very comprehensive process. It takes many different elements within it. So we don't teach our students what to do, how to do. We teach them this skill and that skill. And we test them on whether they can do this procedure, yes, or that procedure. We don't test them on learning to do, because there's never yet been a good book written about learning to do. I was going to write it until I was taken ill a few months ago. And I have a contract which will never get fulfilled now, I'm afraid, because I haven't got the intellectual energy to do it anymore. But the whole point is, in order to learn to do, I've got to have a philosophy of learning. And we don't have philosophies of learning in our training anywhere. In order to learn to do, I've got to understand the processes. I've got to also understand me. Because you see, much of our bodily learning at the moment is based upon the fact that I have no mind at all. So we look at Skinner, behaviorism, we look at information processing, and we say it's just like a computer, we're putting it through. And in a sense, we teach our students to be like that. Here's the information, process it and do it. But I'm active. I play my part. So I'm not a monist, I'm not a person who says I have no mind at all. But much theory is based upon the idea that the mind is inactive if I have one at all, and it's all the brain. But if I was a Cartesian dualist, I would want to hold the two apart. And philosophically, that has real big problems. It really does. I think it's a better problem, solution, than the monist one. But there is a third solution, which we call non-reductive monism, which is basically a combination of dualism of purpose and monism of substance. But you see, in order to answer my problems of learning to do, I've got to know about me as a person, and I've got to know the philosophy of my mind and my body. And we don't teach it in learning. And so we are faced with a very interesting situation. We're faced with a situation, you see, where in everyday life, we're doing things we don't know we're doing. We're remembering things we don't know we're remembering. But we don't call that learning. And what we call learning are the things that we know we're learning. And that has its own problems. Because all of you who've been in practice a long time know how much, or you don't know how much you've learned from practice. But you do know when you reach situations that you can reach solutions without having to go through all the processes. Because as we learn to be an expert, we learn that we have forgotten all those steps because we look at the whole thing holistically. We're utilizing the whole person, but we're utilizing the whole person often without being aware of it. Expertise, then, is something that takes a long time. You can't learn expertise in an apprenticeship. You can't learn expertise in the first 2 or 3 years of practice. To become an expert, you're going to spend 9 or 10 years doing it and doing it and repeating it and rehearsing trial and error. But you see, the whole thing about a craft is the craftsman wants to produce perfection. And that takes time. The whole thing about a profession is the professional wants to do the best for his or her client. And that takes time. And if we're going to be professionals, we've really got to try to be experts. We've got to learn what expertise is. And we've got to live with the idea of things like conjectural knowledge. Recognize the significance of instinctive knowledge, as it were. But recognize that these things only come because we've spent time in practice, doing it and doing it and doing it again. I learned to be an expert by doing. But as Husserl says, I live in my actions, in my acts. What I do is a picture of me. It is the image of me that I want to present to the world out there. It's the me that I have learned by my professional practice. For ultimately, I am my practice. Thank you. Sorry, I messed that up.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? No, no. Thank you very much. Peter Jarvis, my first reaction when you really warmed up was, what have I done? What have I done to invite you into a university college? Where we're actually doing conscious learning, teaching. That's our business, that's what we're in for. And now you all know that you might be experts from all your unconscious knowing what you didn't know. I think this was a really fantastic speech you gave us, Peter Jarvis, because when you really think about what you've said, I think we've all experienced knowledge like that. So after having swallowed your point, I think I at least have a question for you, because before you had 3, 4, 5 minutes for some questions. That is, I think that one of our main purposes in the education of business is perhaps finding a language that can translate, so to speak, all this unconscious knowledge so that we can share the knowledge that we didn't know. So my question is, could that be a bridge closing the gap between?
I think that's a very, very interesting and an important question. You see, the knowledge that I learn explicitly, I'm conscious of. The knowledge that I learn implicitly, I'm not conscious of. Now, in order to watch that master baker, the researcher had to spend months watching the practice. Now, I think one of the things we've got to help our students to do is to watch the practice of the people with whom they work, who are there longer, and just see how they've adapted things. So that they can copy them, if you like. We don't learn these, we can learn these things in isolation because the weavers might well have done so. But most of us, because we work in teams, we work with people at different levels of expertise. And I think instead of sort of saying to our students, you know, well, you don't know, you're a beginner. I think what we've got to say is there are people out there from whom we can learn who can't necessarily teach us, but from whom we can learn. And if those experienced people are happy to be watched, then the learning can take place. And if sometimes we can actually video really good, interesting, and innovative practices and just let our students see them and show how they don't conform always to the theories of doing, how perhaps sometimes we just interview a really experienced nurse in the school and get that experienced nurse to say, well, I don't know how I learned it, but this is what I do. And make our students have the confidence of not knowing, because it's only when you don't know that you can learn, but also of not knowing and not being frightened of not knowing.
Thank you very much. I'm sure there must be hundreds of questions here. We will have time if anyone would like to ask Peter Jones a question.
Thank you, first of all, for a wonderful lecture. I teach myself at Roskilde University as a sociologist, and I'm curious about one point. I started out about 10 years ago teaching my students, and we were reading books, Habermas, Adorno, Honneth, very difficult books. And now I seem to be in a new type of position that we don't have the time anymore
to read books. What we do is we read texts. So we the prerequisites of learning for 10,000 hours seem to have slipped away in the education system. And I'm having difficulties giving my students my expertise.
Yeah.
And because time is has come under pressure, or as Hartmut Rosa, the German sociologist, tells us in his new book, that time has accelerated. So the prerequisites of actually getting uninterrupted 10,000 hours have become very, very difficult.
But it's 10,000 hours of learning, not 10,000 hours of teaching. And much of that... thank God! but the really significant thing is, I don't know I'm learning most of the time when I'm doing. So it's to get people out there doing. Now, one of the problems with reflective practice is that what we're trying to do with reflective practice is get people to bring to the consciousness the things that they've learned. But many of them are hard to bring to the consciousness simply because they have been unconscious learning experiences. One of the other stories I was going to tell you if I gave you my proper lecture was that when I was a teacher trainer, I trained both school teachers and adult teachers. And one of the things I often used to do when I went out and watched lessons, as my colleagues used to say at the end when we did this little reflective bit, tell me what went wrong. Now that's very easy to do, because if you make a mistake, you're conscious of it. Right? I always should say to my students, tell me what was good about that lecture. And that was very impossible to do, because we're not conscious of what we're doing if it's going well. It's only when it's going badly we bring it to our consciousness. So to get students to say, I suppose that went well, or yeah, that was quite good, and to say, yes, that was a damn good lecture because, I saw this and I saw that. You did it. You didn't have to think about it. You were doing it. So the difference, I think, is the difference of conscious learning. And the observer is conscious of much of the learning, where the doer isn't. It's just, I'm going back to that Polanyi experience or a hammer. I'm conscious of what I'm doing. And those little things, or that little word I say to the student, or that little smile I give to the student of encouragement, yeah? They don't get recorded in my mind, but the observer can see them. And I think that's important. So it's basically the fact that one of the troubles about, you know, what you say about Habermas is that we move people around so often. We often move them around before they've had time to really become an expert. I mean, those of you who work on very complicated nursing situations would know how long it takes, how long it takes to become an expert in a casualty ward, for instance, or something like that. It's not something you learn overnight or over a week or a month, because you may have some emergencies that only occur once every few months, and so it's living through these and mastering them. Yeah?
I'm working with the medical simulation as teaching form, and I would like to hear your opinion about can that be the way of be teaching doing rather than knowing, or a gap between doing and knowing?
I think simulation is something that is very, very important. I mean, for very complicated occupations and professions, like being a pilot, you can only learn those situations by doing them, by being there, by having that experience. Now, I guess, and I don't know how far advanced nurse education is in this, but I guess you could simulate some very, very major emergencies that nurses could do in a simulator, or in a simulated situation, which we don't necessarily need the theory for. Because as I put in my practitioner researcher book, I learn my own meaning after I've done it. And if I've done a thing like a simulation, and I've sat back with somebody else who's done it, and we can talk together, that may be a very important learning situation. There was a very enlightened school head teacher in New York a few years ago who did this with her school staff. She paired her staff up, and in every semester she programmed the pair together three times. On one, the one person taught and the other watched. On the second, the other person taught and the first person watched. And on the third, they sat down with a cup of coffee and discussed the pros and the cons of what they had learned from each other. Now that was brilliant, because it's doing just the type of thing, you know, that you're saying. I'm not asking for a theory, but I did like the way you did that, you know? And that's important. And we're learning in practice, but with a very, in that case, I think a very, very insightful head who made sure that her staff were teaching each other. I thought that was good. No theory, just doing it and watching.
Thank you very much. I think we have all many more questions. At least we have questions that we are asking ourselves on our way back home. At least I cannot wait till I will look critically together with all my employees to see what are we actually doing. We boast that all our programs, educational programs, are mixtures between theory and practice. We boast that we do not develop any kind of educational program without you, without people who are actually working at the hospitals, for example. But I think that this kick-off lecture will make me look even more critical on doing it. Do we really include all the tech learning, and do we do it in the right way? What a wonderful kick-off for such a learning day. I know that you will find your hotel much easier. But if you do have a little time left, I think you should consider how on earth did we know the plans of this conference? That you would make us fly, that you were the very best person to send us flying on this day. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm sorry you didn't quite get the lecture that I meant to give, but here it is.